Signore e signori, buonasera, benvenuti alla Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò della New York University. We are delighted to host our traditional partner for several events during the year, the Bogliasco Foundation. And we are particularly pleased that for this first event of the academic year, they have chosen this presentation on a very special edition of The Merchant of Venice that was set in Venice, in the ghetto of Venice, for the first time ever, I understand. So we're going to have the fortune of having the director, who is also the person that conceived the project, and three actors that were in Venice for this adventure. Before I ask the president of the Bogliasco Foundation to address you, I would like to remind the people that are following us in live streaming that they can ask questions for the director, for the actors, and either through our Facebook page or Twitter, and the hashtags we are using are Shakespeare's and The Merchant of Venice, or CIZM, Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò. So either one of those things, if you have questions and you're not physically present here in the auditorium, you can ask them in that way. If you're here, obviously, just raise your hand and open your mouth, the old fashioned. Without further ado, I would like to ask you to please welcome the president of the Bogliasco Foundation, Laura Harrison. Thank you.
So good evening, everyone. Welcome once again. And on behalf of the Bogliasco Foundation, I want to thank, first of all, Stefano Albertini, Kostya, all of the Casa Italiana crew. We are immensely grateful to be able to come to the Casa Italiana every year. This is, in fact, our sixth presentation here in 4 years. It's an organization that has values and a mission that are closely aligned with our own. It's a joy to be here, so our sincere thanks to all of you. Before introducing tonight's main speaker, I wanted to just say a few words about the Bogliasco Foundation for those of you who might not know about us. The foundation is an American nonprofit operating in Italy. Our mission is to support the arts and humanities and international cultural exchange by providing residential fellowships for international artists and scholars at our residency program in Bogliasco, which is near the city of Genoa. Taking inspiration from that great ancient port city, which has brought global travelers together throughout the ages, the program provides ideal work conditions and encourages cross-pollination in a diverse community comprised of some of the world's most innovative minds. In 20 years of operation, this being our 20th anniversary year this year, we have hosted well over 850 fellows from 55 countries. And each year, we tack on an additional 50 to that number. Our program celebrates creativity, diversity, collaboration, and encourages meaningful conversation, not only at our study center, but also via our outreach program, by sharing work that was produced at our study center with audiences worldwide, such as is the case tonight. And we could not be more delighted to have Karin Coonrod with us tonight. She was a theater fellow in the spring of 2015. I believe she was probably putting the finishing touches on this extraordinary production while she was in residence, but we'll hear more about that, I'm sure. I know that we're all looking forward to hearing more about this incredible production, which happened just this summer. Just a few words about Karin. Apparently, although she's born in Chicago, her earliest memories are of a small, beautiful Ligurian town named Noli, which happens to be just a few miles north of Bogliasco in the same region of Italy. She is a theater director whose work has been called prodigiously inventive by the New York Times. She's been on the faculty of the Yale School of Drama since 2002 and has founded not one but two theater companies over the years, in particular her current company, which is the Compagnia di Colombari, based here in New York, but they perform, I understand, worldwide. Some of those recent productions include Monteverdi's Orfeo in Orietto, Italy in 2014, Gertrude Stein's The World is Round, is Round, is Round in 2013 in Albany, and Karin's own texts and Beheading Elizabeth R. at the Folger Theater in Washington and also at the BAM Next Wave Festival in 2015. She is best known, perhaps, for her theater, her Shakespeare productions, and some of those, the highlights include, in addition to Merchant of Venice, The Tempest at La Mama Theater in 2014, Love's Labor's Lost at the Public in 2011, King John, Julius Caesar, and Coriolanus, all with theater for a new audience between 2000 and 2005. Just one last word. This is one of a series of events in celebration of the Bogliasco Foundation's 20th anniversary year. And I'm so deeply grateful to Karin for being here with us tonight and for being a part of that celebration. So don't forget to save your questions for the Q&A. We have a reception upstairs afterward, which everyone is invited to. And please join me in welcoming Karin Coonrod.
Thank you, Laura, so much, and the Bogliasco Foundation, because really the residency that I had there in 2015 was very, very precious time, and I did develop many, many ideas there, and when I wasn't staring out the window at the seascapes. That is extraordinary. And thank you, Casa Italiana and Stefano, for hosting this lovely event. Really great, and thank you all for coming. For your interest in this really thrilling and beautiful project that we were able to generate. I also want to introduce very quickly, although we'll talk and answer questions together a little bit later, Ned Eisenberg over here, who played Shylock, one of the Shylocks. And Linda Powell, who played Portia. And Mika Uranowitz, who played Jessica. and Walter Valeri, who was my dramaturg. And also, yes. So, I'm delighted. Some of the people involved may be watching right now, which is pretty exciting, but it's wonderful that those on the East Coast, you could be here. So buonasera and grazie tutti. thank you so much for being here. How did this project come to be? A lot of people ask. What was the beginning of all this? So I just want to take us back a little bit, go through a couple of ideas of this play, then show some pictures and a few film clips, and then we'll ask and answer and entertain some questions together. But first of all, in early January 2014, on a wintry, cold day in the ghetto of Venice, two professors were walking and together, and one was David Scott Castan, who's the Shakespearean from Yale, and the other is Shaul Bassi, who is a professor from Ca' Foscari and also a sort of informal mayor of the ghetto in some ways, a remarkable spirit. The two of them were talking about what to do to celebrate the commemoration of the 500 years of the founding of the ghetto and the 400 years of Shakespeare's death. That this intersection of commemorations was something that was on their mind, so coming up in about 2.5 years. So they thought, you know, we should bring The Merchant of Venice to Venice, to the ghetto, to be played right here. Very provocative idea. but they thought of that, and they also did not want to do a ready-made production. It was pretty clear in their minds that they didn't want a big-name company, nor something that was made outside of Venice, but rather something that was made in Venice, which, as you know, those of you who've been to Venice, it's you find less and less things made there, but a lot of people coming there. So it was something that they definitely wanted to see done. So they came to me, because I am the artistic director of a company Compagnia di Colombari that has worked in Italy for 12 years. And also, because I have quite a history of doing Shakespeare, the two seemed to match, and they came to me and invited me to come to Venice. So it was, when I got that email, that was pretty exciting, needless to say. So, and then, you know, this whole business of the play and the ghetto, because really there's no mention of the ghetto in the play. A lot of people have hastened to tell me this, but you know, I did know that. But still, it's known for its Venetian local color. And you know, what news on the Rialto and the decrees of Venice, and which in Italy we turn to Venezia and so forth. But all these things, of course, make for something that is certainly set and played there. But what to do about this business of the ghetto, especially with a play that had so much baggage, that is known for being anti-Semitic. Some people now say it absolutely is anti-Semitic. And there were people, and we can address that too, that were opposed to it. But I think most people were really surprised by the thing. I feel that, in fact, and to place this play right on the stones of the ghetto, in the middle, was really, really kind of an extraordinary thing to do, a lot of chutzpah, and a way in which we could confront and address what has happened and also be there, and in a time when in this 501st year, the ghetto and the culture of the ghetto wanted to move forward and have a huge embrace, not unlike what it was in the 1500s. So with this 400 years and 500 years and across the centuries, we're saying, you know, how do we bridge all these centuries to play the now of the play in this time and in this place? And that was our exhilaration, actually, to kind of work on that, to figure that out, to consider the place that we would be, and we can also talk about that, and then to be there and to see what would come up out of it. So you may ask too, was there ever another production in Venice of this play? And in fact, there was, but not in the ghetto. So the very famous and great German director, Max Reinhardt, did The Merchant in Venice in 1934 in Campo San Treviso. And of course he had 400 people involved. We only had about 40. But anyway, still, it was a play that had never been done in the ghetto. So this was our charge and our joy. My feeling as I listened to the play and working on it, was that it's not, in fact, anti-Semitic, but frames anti-Semitism and all those anti-others, and exposes, in fact, the hypocrisy. I need some water. Sorry. Thanks a lot. Yeah. The hypocrisy of the dominant culture, and with the exposure, you know, this is what, in fact, the play is leading to. But you know, and that's what drew me as I listened to it, as I was working on it more and more and more, and talking to many people. But let me first of all just tell you a little bit about the company and a little bit about how I approached it, which was different, and then we'll look at some picture slides, and which we're very lucky to have, sort of little beginnings of things. So the company is actually, and how we put this enterprise together, because we worked with an international company. So that in itself is not, you know, that's why a lot of people, you know, say, no, we're going to do it ready-made, we're going to come, you know, our group, and we understand them. No, we did it the hard way. We worked with Americans and Italians, and there were many nationalities actually involved. Australians and Romanians and Indians and French and all manner of people. We spoke many languages, mostly in English, but we did have some Veneziano, you'll hear some tonight, and some Italian, street Italian, and we did have a little bit of French, a little bit of Spanish, a little bit of Arabic, and Judeo-Venetian, Veneziano, Judeo-Venetian, Ladino a little bit, and a little bit of Yiddish. So, yes, those were the languages. And then some of the key, there were many, many, to make this team, as you can imagine, was an extraordinary event. But I need to talk about a few people very in haste. Peter Cassander and I, who have worked together for many years, he was the set and light designer. And with him in November, we knew that when we went for a visitation there, we had to put it right, that we didn't want to build a set. We were going to place ourselves right in the middle of the Campo Nuovo. And it's sort of the ground zero of the place of Jewish culture. And that we would be looking at, and you'll see it, the synagogue, La Scuola Tedesca and La Scuola Italiana, the two synagogues, Italian and German, and with their five windows. We would be looking at that portion of the architecture, which was the most interesting. Then also involved was Stefano Nicolaou. I know Peter is from America, from Portland, Oregon, but Stefano Nicolaou is from Venice. And he's been Oscar-nominated costume designer, and his atelier happened to be right outside the ghetto. So you can imagine when this was brought to me, the idea of perhaps, you know, working with Stefano, and I met him, his costumes are very traditional, made, and he does a lot of, you know, all kinds of things. Brilliant collaborator, but we were creating together a very fluid aesthetic. Monochromatic, and also something that could cross back and forth, and also create a silhouette that was Renaissance while with modern details, so that we had a hybrid of these things. And so it demanded going into making something that was new and had not been seen before, which is always my joy, to make the thing. Like the Greek word for poet. So, and then another person that was involved is Frank London, who is the leader of the Klezmatics and the founder, and we were mighty lucky to have him with us playing his trumpet. And we talked together about the opening piece, which we wanted to be like comedy tonight, you know, something really, really lively and bright that would bring an audience into a different kind of spirit, into a comic. You know, it is called a comedy, but then there are other things that happen, that develop. Then of course, a piece of music from the beginning that he was setting to music was brought to me because of my conversations with Walter Valeri, my dramaturg. We had a few dramaturgs involved, but that we had many conversations with. But Walter brought, and I laughed together in my living room about the Commedia dell'arte, and how really some of those scenes were so wanted to be in Italian, because Shakespeare was so influenced by the Commedia dell'arte. And we were going to be in Venice, where the Commedia dell'arte reigns supreme. So he brought to me a piece of text by Ruzzante, who, and he may mention a little bit something about this later, that was the prologue that I accepted. We talked about a few things, and then this was the thing that was perfect. And we placed it as a prologue, and then some of that was set to music. And you'll hear a little bit of that, actually, in a minute. And then Gigi Buffington, who did the voice and text and worked with all the company in learning the English, because many of the Italians, you know, needed a lot of coaching and so forth. So she was indefatigable in terms of her work. So all together, and then the team, the whole team, we hardly had time to even see each other because people were resting. But and trying, to, you know, when we weren't working like mad, they were just trying to rest. But it was an extraordinary gathering of strangers. So how altogether we were aiming for a production that would bridge these 500 years. And the question begins, for me, was, well, how to present Shylock? And everyone, usually that's one of the first questions that people asked. So, and of course, we've seen a lot of wonderful performances by individual actors of Shylock that are memorable and even unforgettable in some cases. For instance, some of you may have seen Al Pacino's, you know, piece either in theater or in the movie, or F. Murray Abraham, another favorite of many, and you know that these are extraordinary performances. But I was not interested in going that direction. I wanted to go a different way, especially as we were going to be doing something in the Jewish ghetto and launching something that could be that would be played in other places. And so, how to mark that? And I wanted to open up the complexity of the character, and to lift it out of, lift it into something both Jewish and universal, something that was, that could be, attach itself to the myriad sort of lightnings of Shylock, his rage, his grief, his wit. And yes, one could say, yes, one could do that, but when you have five, and it seems the danger is, of course, that it could be distracting, or that it could be maybe, you know, this fractured portrait might be confusing or so forth, but I feel that it was very, very exciting. And I'm going to explain something. Let me set something up for you about one of the scenes, which was, for me, the turning point as I worked and worked on the play, because it's very, as you know, it's a complex one. Some people say everything else can be played, but not this one. So it's banned in some places, or has been, and it's also played in wildly different ways. So we were all aware of this, but for me, when I was working on the play, so consider this, Jessica, the daughter of Shylock, leaves him and becomes a Christian. She betrays him. She steals away from him and steals his money. Things are, you know, the Jews are marginalized, even though the word ghetto is not in the play. The Jews are certainly marginalized, and we get that right from the beginning in the first scene of Shylock, where Antonio says to Shylock, you know, well, Shylock, shall we be beholden to you? They want to take the money and run. Bassanio and Antonio, they just want to take the money and run. He says, and I will spit on you again. And it's really, when you read the scene and you go into it, and our rehearsals, you know, had sometimes people in tears. You know, it's extraordinary. The mercy that is not shown by the Christian in the first scene with the Jew. So, you know, from there we have our starting point. But the thing that I want to set up for you, just to give you a sense, and we'll actually see a little piece of it, is the section with Shylock number 3. So Jessica has just run away, and she's laughing, and the men, you know, she's with Lorenzo and the Christians, and she's escaping because she, in her mind, and when he finds out about this, he's filled with grief, and he knows he's been had by the community. And so what I did was I felt that this was very much the turning point, and that the five Shylocks would come together. This is the middle of the play, sort of, as Peter said, it's sort of where the play comes unhinged. The five Shylocks who played other characters came together in a huge circle surrounding the center, the ground zero of the Campo Nuovo. And the rest of the company played the part of the Venetians, and they took the lines that were normally given to Salagno or Salarino. And they mocked him and taunted him and made fun of him and used his own words and spat at him, and the five. And the five were very, very still. and just listening. And of course, I think, you know, it's a thing that I think we can all enter into a moment when we've had difficulty. Surviving childhood is enough experience for being an artist, and for it, that's all we need to do to take from ourselves, you know, our own experience, surviving childhood, and knowing what those moments are like. This is, a moment where their voices and their laughter and their cackling and their taunting was really huge, and then became a kind of rhythm, and there was a noise all over. And the Shylocks start to come together. Imagine this, the five. They're also changed into what marks the Jew, which, and you'll see a picture, which is a gold sash. Instead of having a Star of David or a circle or an arm sash or anything small, this is operatic. It needed to be really huge because we were playing in a huge space. And I kind of get exhilarated by that, actually. I love that. So the sashes were placed on them and they became Shylock. They moved towards each other, and then one of them breaks all the sound with a huge howl that came up from the stones and up to the sky, you know, and was took no prisoners, let's put it that way. And one audience member, a French artist, said this was like a healing for the ghetto. This was an extraordinary moment, because when she heard it every day, this moment, every night of the performance, it was like a wail that came out. And that Shylock was played by a woman. So somewhat improbable, but a little bit improbable, like Venice itself. So, that a woman in this moment, and it was just one of those things that, you know, I don't strategize and then think, that's going to be, it just was the right thing. It was, we did a rehearsal, and we can even talk about that. She was remarkable. Jenny Lee Jones from Wales, actually, and played that role. So that, to me, the woman in the center with all the Shylocks with their particular talent, you know, extraordinary gifts, playing all these five was something that was quite extraordinary, I think. And also it struck me very much coming up out of the play was that there was a bond, a call for a bond. I will have my bond. And, you know, Shylock repeats that over and over. And for me, in a way, that was a little bit like, a legal penalty and a legal something that needs to be paid, but it's also something to do with connection. And I think that there's something calling up out of this play that wants that. So in this time and in this place, we were going for great, great resonances. So there were two times that the Shylocks all came together. The second time I'm not going to tell you about, that was at the end of the play. We are going to do this play again in Montclair next September in 2017, so maybe I just have to come and see that. But I'm going to show now some images that are taken by Andrea Misana, and also some film clips that are taken by Elizabeth Kaufman and Ted Harden, who were there for 5 weeks capturing everything that we did. Here we go. I just put it up there, Julian. So this is our set. So this is our set, and this is the German synagogue, and the Italian one is here, and we set our grandstand bleachers here that seated 250 people, facing, just confronting this architecture. And we had to fight this little window. was a little bit of a house called the Shylock House. We found that out afterwards. But in fact, it was the window that I had my eye set on, and I said, we need to have Jessica appear at that window. And it must happen. And we found out that the man who owned that lived in Parma anyway, and we called him Parma Man. And we finally got the window. It took a lot of effort of some of our beautiful team to make that happen and to see that that was essential to the play, because we were not building anything on the actors would tread on the stones with their feet. So that was our set, and you see that is the Campo Nuovo, which is an island within an island. And here and here all around. So it was extraordinary to report to work. This, I know that there's been interest in this, so I thought I would show one image of the mock trial that happened. This is from an iPhone, but the lawyers and then Ruth Bader Ginsburg in the middle, with the jury of five judges, James Shapiro on the far right over there in the bright blue, and Stephen Greenblatt was there too, but we only see James. So this was in the Scuola San Rocco, where it's covered with Tintorettos. And because of the tremendous sponsorships that we had to do this piece, that was one of the wonderful benefits that our beautiful board and our team of people made happen. Shaul and everybody made it happen. So it's great. These are now, I'm going to go through these fast. This is in 2015, and you might recognize Reggie Cathy. He was slated to be our Antonio, and we were working like crazy in 2015 in a little workshop for 2 weeks, and then his shooting schedule changed, and so he couldn't be with us, but we had a wonderful actor called Stefano Scherini, who was an Italian. Here's us in 2015. We also did some rehearsals at the BBC Cot, and Reggie and Sorab and Michele, and many of them stayed with us. We went to the Palazzo Ducale, and actually Mika took this picture of the rehearsal right there in the exhibit of the Jewish exhibit in the Palazzo Ducale. This is the ghetto as we saw it in November. And of course, one big difference, you know, when you're in situ and on location, you know that the trees are gonna grow a little. We always laughing about, well, could we just get out there in the midnight and, you know, cut a couple branches? I say that with impunity now, but no, you couldn't really say that. But anyway, they did get greener and bright, and so we had to think about all of that. This is the first rehearsal with Frank directing the opening song, and everybody, you know, doing the table work, and Walter and Davina from Yale, and me in the middle making cuts. This is Gigi, who's working with Adriano, who played Shylock number two, and Peter Cassander, and I looking at a computer rendering of the set, working in situ. The days were very, very hot. So, you know, the memories of the days and how people sometimes were, there was no air conditioning for a long time. So anyway, there were a lot of challenges, but the joy of the thing, working with Andrea, he was Shylock number four, and Jessica and Lorenzo, Jessica, Stefano, our costume designer, and me looking at, you know, this first fitting of Jessica's outfit. Then the whole business of how the set gets to the island. I mean, you know, the thing that we didn't think about, and that nobody much thinks about unless you live and have experience in Venice, is that when you're doing something in situ, you don't just say, you know, a truck doesn't pull up to the theater and then back in and, you know, the techies come out and do all their stuff. No, what happens is the truck goes to the boat goes to the island, then the men take, you know, the stuff from the boat and wheel it along to the place. That's, by the way, that's Marciano, who was our godfather and Angelo, you know, enormous, Archangelo, really. And this, you know, was taken, I think, by Stefano, Peter behind me, because we were just so thrilled by the grandstand that was built and the wall of lights, and we were barricaded. I mean, it was just thrilling. It's really living. This is the opening night, taken from someone's iPhone, but I wanted to show this because it gave you a sense of the audience and what they saw. This is, you know, we worked under tremendous pressure. 3 weeks, which is, anybody in the theater knows that that's very challenging. So anyway, but we did it. And it was remarkably, a lot of love was poured into it, a lot of human expense. But it was a joy and it was also a miracle. So, but here we're talking about the night before the final dress, when it was, the final dress was sold out, so you know, the pressure was on. The musicians, a beautiful team who sat right in the middle of the space and then sometimes were involved in the action. Now this is the clips from the opening night, okay? So this is a little piece of film. All right, you're gonna see arrive famous guests.
Benvenuti allo spettacolo The Merchant in Venice di William Shakespeare, diretto da Karin Coonrod.
Christian, go. Here is the money. Soft. Okay. So just moving on, because it's going to be a few pictures and a couple of clips, and this is the opening, a couple of pictures of Francesca Saratoic, who played Lancilotto, and now I have something, a little clip of this opening in Veneziano here. Let's, so you see what, oops. Ah, yes, here we go, sorry.
Investa voi a seccarsi in mezzo tra i due e fate due uno e così tutti se nasce. Amore, ah! Ma l'amore non si sa mettere in sei giovani e negli uomini in età della donna. Garzonseo de Stala, a lei innamorata, a voi subito guardarsi la festa. Amore, ah! Ma l'amore non può diventare ballerini, cantarini, gaggiardi e saltarini. Amore, ah! Ma che cancro sarà che disgrazia che non vorrà parlare d'altro che d'amore! This is the first scene, the first Shylock with Antonio. I like this shot because it really captures the sort of disgust of the Antonio that he will not give the money fast, that it's just, you know, it just captures that little moment. This is a moment of Aragon serenading Portia. And it was a little flamenco song. We added little, like the earlier piece with the two duelings, tenors, little pieces of music. So we set some of the text to music. Here's Lancilotto and Jessica and Shylock number two, Adriano from Croatia, Sorab is from India, Adriano from Italy and Croatia, really. And then the dueling tenors. And then here's, this is also a little clip. And this is where Lorenzo and Jessica comes to the window. So, and Lorenzo, is late.
Sweet friends, your patience for my long abode. Not I, but my affairs have made you wait. When you shall please to play the thieves for wives, I'll watch as long for you then. Approach. Here dwells my father, Jew. Oh, who's with it?
Who are you? Tell me for more certainty.
Lorenzo, and thy love.
Lorenzo, certain, and my love indeed. For who love I so much, and now who knows? But you, Lorenzo, whether I am yours.
Heaven and thy thoughts are witness that thou art.
Here, catch this casket. It is worth the pains.
Now, by my hood, a Gentile and no Jew.
Beshrew me, but I love her heartily. For she is wise, if I can judge of her. And fair she is, if that mine eyes be true. And true she is, as she hath proved herself, and therefore, like herself, wise, fair, and true, shall she be placed in my constant soul.
Lorenzo!
What? Art thou come?
that's the sound, the Frank's trumpet that was played on the roof that called the five Shylocks together. And this is, these are shots of that. And then here's a moment of this, that we see the howl that comes. This is the sounds stop. Here we go.
She used to fly with all.
And Shylock, for his own part, knew the bird was fledged, and that it is the complexion of them all to leave the dam.
He is damned for it.
Oh, that's certain, if the devil may be her judge.
Mephia, my own flesh and blood to rebel.
Vergogna!
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 So, and the other Salarino then comes around, and this is just another shot. This is Andrea Bruniera playing Shylock number 4 with Ned playing Tubal at this moment. And then Portia and Bassanio. After all that happens, then the lead casket is chosen. And the looks between the two of them, and I love this shot too of the two of them, because the eyes, their eyes were always so penetrating. And so it's really exciting. Of course, the task was to make it operatic and huge, and that was, when we went to the ghetto, that was a remarkable challenge, but we had done all the work inside, and you can see so much of that still. It'd be great to keep doing it. And there's the letter that we decided that Portia would read it, and instead of having him read it, and they all listen, and so forth, and the letter that Antonio sends. And this is Portia and Nerissa running to the traject to go to Padova and then to go to Venezia as the lawyers. And, but you see the androgyny of the costumes, so that there were diaphanous kind of clothes, dresses over trousers, and the fluidity of it, so a man could play a woman a man, women could play women playing men, you know, so forth. I mean, it was a wonderful game. So here's a little piece of yellow string that Jessica still had from childhood that she kept with her and was playing Cat's Cradle with Lancelotto. Here's Ned Eisenberg, who's with us in as Shylock number 5. And I was so excited because Ned and I have worked before happily in King John, and he played the title role, and that he played Shylock number 5. I wanted to give him this scene, which was so rich and extraordinary and fierce. And so here we have Graziano attacking him, Portia as the lawyer, Stefano and Ned in that moment in the middle. Then when he, after the second Terry, when he's brought back and he knows that, you know, that he's done in actually. We also involved the audience. So we had 20 people sitting in the space, but along the side. And at a certain point, I wanted the sea of red, and red represented, everything was just a gesture. You know, the red was for Venice, so Jenny, who played Shylock III, also plays the Duke with the red cloak, and everyone else had a stola, or like a shawl, red stola. And there were some of the Black Angels who I call, these are the beautiful assistants to the scene. They do all the changes, bring the knives, bring the basket, take everything away, change the clothes and everything, right in front of people so that it's nothing is hidden. And they, two of them were in charge, Ziv and Alessandra, of bringing the audience at a certain point so that when Shylock turned around, he would see a sea of people. This idea of sort of like a red sea of people that were decided against him. Oh, sorry, that's in there twice. And this is Paul, Lorenzo, and Jessica in the final scene, the final moment, with the Shylocks coming forward. Then just very quickly, we also did two, after Venice, and partly I wanted to test it while we were all together, that we could go to two other places. It turned out to be, you know, very rushed and everyone was extremely tired. And I probably was demanding far too much of everybody, but it was a desire to go to Bassano and to do the play in a beautiful place. So you see, they told us that we really kind of rocked the space a little bit, which made me happy because we only went there and rehearsed for about 2 hours. But it was a stunning place with beautiful sound, and I was excited because I knew that the play worked outside the ghetto. So you can imagine, because it was hard to tear ourselves away from the ghetto, but then we did go to Bassano, and we saw that it was glorious. Then our final performance was in a prison, in the Padova prison, where the prisoners bake bread. They're known for, it's called the Giotto, Cooperativa Giotto, and the prisoners bake bread and it's sold all around Italy. So when the prisoners get out, they're rehabilitated and only 2% are brought back to prison. Most of them are rehabilitated and they have something that they're proud of. And I was so overjoyed to have this open up as an experience for all of us. So this, you know, there happened to be some speeches, the inmates coming in. We had about 100 people, and then I do have a little clip from this. You see Lancilotto, Miki, who, you know, was really overwhelmed and tears, and this. Here's a little moment of that final scene here. And you'll see with the prisoners, they were also participating in that moment against Shylock. So there, some of them are a little bit distracted looking, you know, they were, the Black Angels brought them all into the place, but they also were assisting to the scene. So those inmates that were working on theater.
Take this scale to my turn in the estimation of a hair. Thou diest, and all thy goods are confiscated.
Second Daniel, a Daniel Jew! How infidel I have you on my head!
Why doth the Jew pause? Take thou thy forfeiture.
Give me my principal and let me go!
I have it waiting for thee. Here it is.
He hath refused it in the open court. He shall have
why does the devil give him good of it? I'll say no longer question.
Tarry, Jew. The law hath yet another hold on you. It is enacted in the laws of Venezia. If it be proved against an alien, that by indirect or direct attempts he seek the life of any citizen, the party against the which he doth contrive shall seize one half his goods. The other half comes to the privy sovereign of the state, and the offender's life lies in the mercy of the Duke only, against all other voice. In which predicament I say thou standst. For it appears by manifest proceeding that thou hast contrived against the very life of the defendant, and thou hast inferred the danger formerly by me rehearsed. Down, therefore, and beg mercy of the Jew.
So, and this, you see all of them, a shot of this with the inmates joining. Yeah, that's it. So that was our final performance in Padova, and then the next day everybody left. So I think what we should do now is just if you have any questions, we can let's just sit across here and we can answer them. Or you know, any thoughts or questions you'd like to ask us. We'll do this in Montclair, New Jersey. So, yes.
Just for clarity.
Yes.
Just for clarity, could you tell us once again who the five Shylocks are?
Sure. Shylock number one is in scene three. It's the first scene of Shylock, and that was played by Saurabh Wadia from India. And Shylock number two was played by Adriano Jurisevic, who was the father. And that's in our scene six, because it was an adaptation that I put together, you know, from just turning, you know, moving things around and making some cuts and so forth. Shylock number three was this turning point, where the five Shylocks come together, and Jenny, who you saw, who breaks into the howl, and she was from Wales. And living in Italy. Then Shylock number four was actually the most Venetian of all. Andrea Bruniera happens to be living in Orvieto now, but was from Bassano. And he played the one who says, I've never felt the curse until now. You know, and he talks about a wilderness of monkeys and Leia and the ring and so forth, and it's a very moving. And then the Shylock number five is our Ned Eisenberg, who is from New York City. I thought that was important. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes. The running time was the same, and it was about 2 hours. It was a little less, you know, I don't actually know. It was a little less than 2 hours. We had to make a few little cuts because I knew it had to be two, you know, not more. So, yes.
Why did you have five Shylocks to begin with?
Well, I wanted to open up the character.
I see.
You know, for all of us to enter in a different way, so that we have a woman, we have different nationalities, we have different ages. We had an older Shylock. Adriano is an older man. Saurabh is younger, but, you know, could get into the dirty merchant. There was a laugh between the merchant and Antonio that then again was between the Shylock number five and the merchant, you know, at the end, the two merchants, you know. So, yeah. Yes. Yes.
Since they all come from different places, how did you recruit all these people?
Recruiting. Well, yes. Last year we had a workshop in Venice, and I brought two actors over from America. We didn't have the funding to really bring anybody else, so I brought two actors, and everybody else, and Walter was there, so and then I brought my assistant from Nerina from Brussels, and our photographer from Brussels as well. And then with the team of Italians there, I was looking around and trying to figure out who would be right to play the different roles. You know, I wanted some people from Venice, from Italy. You know, we definitely wanted that. We didn't, as I said at the beginning, this was an international company. We wanted to make it in Venice. And we wanted to be local, global, and work together. And it was really joyous last year Reggie and Saurabh were giving English lessons to all the Italians. It was pretty funny. So if any questions for any of the, because here's, yes. Right.
And they were telling me how different was the every place was a different, completely different experience. So for you, and for the director as well, but for you is how was it to act in the ghetto, and how was that to bring that experience that is, I believe, is like kind of unique.
each space was completely different, and I think created a different kind of vibe for each performance. We rehearsed in a small auditorium. So the first jump for us was going from that auditorium to the ghetto itself. It was kind of a culture shock for us, moving from the rehearsal space into where we were going to perform. So that was a sobering day. And we only had five performances in the ghetto. Six performances in the ghetto. And each performance grew, and we started to feel the relationship between the audience and the space and ourselves more and more. And just when we were grasping that it was over and we were on a bus to Bassano, and Bassano was such a romantic, beautiful, gorgeous space in a different way from the ghetto, pastoral almost. And it was because of the space and because we had never been in it before that I think there was an abandoned that performance, a relief at being let loose in a different environment. And it was a festival, so it was, in the ghetto there was the weight of the ghetto, and in Bassano there was the lightness of the festival, kind of, I think. And then the very next day, we were on a bus to on a train to the prison, and the prison was. I think we all felt a responsibility in the prison to. I'm not sure the word. Bear witness for the audience, you know, to be present in a very specific way for that specific audience, and it was very contained. And so I know you could see there was a lot of each space created a different choreography, and in the prison I felt a lot of circles happening, and that created a different energy than we'd had any other place. But luckily, we had a group of people who were flexible. And had, you know, lived through 4 weeks of trial by fire, and we were kind of war buddies by that point. So it was just like, here we go, let's see what happens. There was a let's see what happens to every performance, even when we were in the ghetto. Yeah.
Did you talk to any of the prisoners?
Not much. I don't think so. No, we saw them. There, but yeah.
We hugged many.
Yeah. Did you? Oh, all right.
I mean, when the performance was done, there were some who were crying, and we were there were lots of tears, because I think it, like Linda said, was very surprising for everyone, and there was this moment at the end where I think they felt seen and we felt seen in a way neither of us, actors, prisoners, had ever experienced before. So there was a real moment. There wasn't a lot said because some of us spoke English, some spoke Italian, but there was just sort of an understanding between everyone, and it was also our last show together. So it was really special.
The question is about bringing the knife in.
Jennifer. Assistant director, yeah. General manager of Colombari, and wore 5,000 hats while in Venice. One of the things was starting the conversation with the prison was every detail had to be outlined before. So we gave list of props, list of people that were coming in, IDs. Everything was checked. So we did provide them the prop list. Having said that, when the knife was in that scene, there was energy in the room, because I'm standing against the wall and I'm watching and I see things start happening and moving. So in the video you might have seen there was one guard who sort of did a very slow walk like this toward our backstage, and he goes straight back to where the props person, one of the Black Angels, went to go put away the knife, collected the knife, took it out of the room, and we got it back at the end of the day after we all left. So yes, that was definitely, there was a moment of jittery tension in that room for that. Good eye.
Yes. Well, I can say one challenge right away, which we will all remember vividly, which is the cicadas were present. They were one. I organized them, you know. And
some people thought it was a sound cue.
Yeah, it was a sound cue. So cicadas stopped at 9:05, and one went on a little longer one night. He was really excited, that one. But you know, that was a challenge at the beginning of the show, the cicadas. But do one of you want? I mean, because the sound was tricky, and we had Andrea Santini working on it. We had made a decision to not have these kind of mics, and rather to have area mics, and you know, for you know, funding reasons and so forth. I mean, there were a lot of different things, but also there was an aesthetic of trying to get the locale, you know, get the place. And so it did mean that we needed to kind of move closer to mics sometimes and had to kind of dance around. I don't know, I mean, the sound was so good at Bassano, wasn't it? I remember it was.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah, talk about that.
Well, for me, it was somewhat easier because the trial scene is very fiery. And I sort of enjoyed having that enormous space to play in. Also, when we first got there, there were no bleachers, and there was no wall of lights, and there was no form, and it was just like a football field. I mean, considering it was a ghetto, it was an awful lot of room, a lovely plaza there. I don't know. I mean, it did not feel cramped in there or over. So, and when we rehearsed, it was... you know, out there. When the man set it up, when Andreas set up the sound, but I did wonder to myself, I don't know how anybody hear this, because these gentler scenes, these quieter scenes, I thought, oh, I don't know. And they're in Italian, and heavily, the Italian actors did an amazing job, but English is not their first language, and they've got to get their mouth around Shakespeare in these terms that it was one thing he said, oh God, man, you got a hard line. It would be hard enough for an English speaker to say that. I figured it was something McKelly had to say or something. But once we had those, he did a brilliant job with those mics.
Yeah.
An absolutely brilliant. And then you didn't feel that you had a yell or you had, it was there, it was in the tree, it was in the fountain. I don't know where he put them, but it was amazing. And also the darkness of night with the lights also helped give a boundary to the set and the world. When we first got there in the bright light of day, it was just like, wow, it's like this is, I don't know what's gonna happen. Yeah, yeah.
That was one of the things that I was alluding to in the switch from the rehearsal space into the ghetto. Suddenly, because of the way the mics worked, a lot of what you had to do
could not be like this at all.
Yeah, so we had to come up with reasons to face forward at almost all times, which changed a lot. So there was like a learning curve with that, and a learning curve of like, okay, how can I get to the well? Because there's a mic by the well. So it's like, la, 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 la. So yeah, it was fun though.
Yes.
This is a question. Like, I talked 1 minute, but I can talk for 1 hour. Because we did work, and with Karin, because Karin is extremely meticulous and see in the very moment that we decided, or she asked me, what do you think about this cut? We had to analyze line by line, word by word, in the languages. The complexity from the point of view of the languages that are in this performance, the complexity and the texture of the languages are extremely, extremely interesting and exciting. We start the mob, to give you just an idea, the monologue that is one piece of the second introduction of the Anconitana, that is one play of Ruzzante, is not the original 16th century Padovano or from Padua, but is an adaptation that the Nobel Prize Dario Fo did when he performed Ruzzante in the festival of Spoleto. And then with the actress, talking with Karin, so this Padovano 16th century transformed in Venetians that was not really Venetian language, but was a kind of mask of the language. We gave the monologue to Francesca Saratoic, and she had to embody the sounds. And she did transformations. So when we are talking of Venetians today, when we are talking of one language, we have two different levels. One level is of the speaker, and the other level is the listener. How much, so one of the jobs of the dramaturg is to be the epiphany of the audience. Can the audience understand this philologically imperfect adaptation of the original text? So this is extremely interesting, first. Second, Shakespeare, when he wrote this play, he had a huge, enormous quantity of material in terms of language, because he used vernacular, he used the mask of the Latin, that means the scheme, one part of Portia dialogue or monologue that is high rhetorical, that is exactly the Latin transfer in the vernacular or English vulgar of the 16th century. How can we work in that way? I have to say bravo to Karin, even tonight, is not for flattering Karin, but because Karin, she did something absolutely fantastic that must be understood even today, because she transfer in terms of mathematics, of grammar, of the action, movement, okay, each line that we did cut, the meaning of the line in itself. So, when they went to see Shakespeare, they didn't say, let's go to see the performance tonight. They said, let's go to listen the performance tonight. Why? Because Shakespeare was a great poet, because he exactly collected all the languages in London that time. He used the structure of Latin, and he collided the two, how can I say, language system of the languages. What Karin did was she putting, complete connection, action, movement, sounds, and music in this performance. This play is one of the most complex, sophisticated plays that I ever worked with, because there are not only two, three plots going together, but we have a system of languages that are absolutely fascinating for the quality, for the variety, and for the intensity. Sometimes it's prose, sometimes it's verse. To give you another example, and then I finish, then I stop. The little song, just because it's anecdotal, could be interesting for you. The little song, Amorea, okay, that Frank did wonderful, okay, I have to say. One day, Karin from New York sent to me an email in Boston, because there is where I live, and I need this song. You have to adapt this song, the original from Shakespeare. I said, okay, what can I do? Shakespeare, the blank verse, okay, 10 syllables. I am Italian. I am from Dante. Let me work with it. Terzina, 11 syllables. So, and then she told me, and remember, Colomba is very good because we are Colombari. So, quale bianche colombe dal desio chiamate, this is one verse from the canto of Paolo e Francesca that I adapted for my director. So,
Walter, say which section of passage of speech this is.
Yes.
This is between Salagno and Salarino.
Between Salagno and Salarino. Yeah. So,
doing tenors,
and this is unbelievably, that means what Karin did, and I still say this is fantastic, because this complexity, and this is the function of the director, must become theatrical, because it's not an essay, okay? It's performance. And she transferred magically and fantastically all this work. We did work for more than 1 year, Karin, and back and forth, coming here. But see, and this is the performance. I have to say, until now, that this production deserve more attention from the critics, because it's not understand, or they didn't understand till now, what Karin Coonrod did with that play, with these fantastic actors.
So, one last question, then maybe there's going to be a reception. That's what I hear. Yes, Frida. Frida.
I want to talk about the elephant in the room. You excuse this as not anti-Semitic. I reread The Merchant of Venice in my hospital bed, not having read it since the 1940s in school. I was stunned.
You didn't see our play. Yeah.
But I mean, I spoke with your husband Jonathan about it, and he had done a lot of reading and research for the role that he played in the mock trial, and you know, he saw my point. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, Frida, you have, I'm sure, many people who agree with you, and I said that from the beginning, but I think what is important is that, you know, if it was purely anti-Semitic and we just went down that road, that would be just plain brutal. I mean, that's just crude, and that would not be of any interest to me. I think that the poet is a great poet, and a great poet may have some assumptions that then are uncovered as he gets involved, because he has many outsiders very interested as a poet in the marginalized. I think he understood being marginalized. I think most of us do. And when he starts, as has been famously said, you know, the humanity, as Herr Bloom has talked about, you know, the Shakespeare, the invention of the human, I mean, the human comes into every single character. The rage of the character is understood when you look at scene three and you see what Antonio says to him. Then Shylock, and actually there's a fellow who's a Bogliasco called Kenneth Gross, and who's written to me, and I just inhaled his book, just subsequent, because I'm obsessed with this play now, you know, reading everything that I hadn't read before. And his book is called Shakespeare is Shylock, or Shylock is Shakespeare. And it's remarkable. It's good stuff. Very deep, very thoughtful. And the rage of the character, and when you look at scene three and how Antonio is impatient with him, and as I said earlier, he wants to take the money and wants to get out of there. He just wants the money from this guy, you know, and he won't even touch him. And this is another thing that we talked about. There was no touching of, and that's why, in a way, the bond, there's a lot of, you know, Shakespeare's full of secrets. There's a lot of stuff. You go into Shakespeare and you go deep, deep, deep. There's no bottom, just like what the character says. There's no bottom to my dream. There's no bottom to this.
Just, yeah. Luckily, I had this, not only the opportunity and the privilege of working with Karin, but a good friend with Vincenzo Cerami, that was the writer, the screenwriter of La Vita è Bella. Do you remember La Vita è Bella?
Of course.
So Benigni and Cerami unfortunately died, but good friend of mine, they did something what's unorthodox from a certain point of view. That means comedy in the concentration camp. They were terrified. So they decide to do broadcast for the private broadcast in Torino for the Levi family. And the Levi family stand, they hug them and said, this is the time. That means is the time to use the two aesthetic to tell the story. The tragedy, we know we have so many tragic aesthetic from the aesthetic point of view. Now let's see us the comedy. What could be the comedy? Shakespeare historically broken the vision of the anti-Israelitic. At that time, they didn't have any idea of anti-Semitic. The anti-Semitism came out in France with the Illuminists. Okay, so the Illuminists invented how can we share the humanity, okay? Semite, blah, 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 blah. That is in the 18th century, end of the 18th century. Shakespeare had personal knowledge of the Jews of Malta, l'Ebreo di Malta. And if you read the Ebreo di Malta, is a mask of grotesque. And this the terminal, the ending on the anti-Semitism that is based in the British literature starting from middle of the 14th century. The British literature was full of this one vision, that means grotesque vision of the victimization, the need of have a victim to discharge the tension in the society. Shakespeare, in that unbelievable monologue, has a Jewish note. And this monologue came after the beginning in the scene two when Antonio and Shylock, and in one aside, Shylock says, I hate him, not only because he's a Christian, but because he's destroying my business, he's competing with my business. So, this is the mask, okay, traditional mask. And immediately after, or during the arch of the scene, we have, I am human. So, the dialectic of being human means I am not completely good, I am not completely bad. This is Harold Bloom. When Harold Bloom says, Shakespeare came out the human, human means I am good, I am bad. I am evil, I am a saint. I am all of this. All of us is something like that. A great Italian poet, Vittorio Sereni, said, for having a century, we need all the best and all the worst for have one century.